Howdy, YouTube family. It's Bolt CRNA coming to you again with another day's topic. Today, we're going to be talking about what specialties you can work in anesthesia. A lot of people, when you think about going to CRNA school, or maybe you're thinking about going into medical school and then doing an anesthesia residency afterwards, you're thinking, you know, you want to do anesthesia, but you don't really know there's multiple specialties within anesthesia, and quite a few people like to specialize and pick one certain area they want to work in. So let's talk about those today. Now to begin, there is of course the general bread and butter, we call them bread and butter type surgery cases that everybody is going to learn no matter what your specialty ends up being. You're going to learn how to handle these basic types of cases. These are going to be your knee replacements, some typical orthopedic type surgeries. It's going to be your intra-abdominal procedures like maybe gastric bypass, or you're going to do a laparoscopic cholecystectomy, which is your gallbladder being taken out. Ventral hernia repairs. Those are all very common bread and butter type cases that everybody, you learn all those cases first, and you learn those types of cases pretty extensively before you branch off into the more specialty types of areas of anesthesia that can be a little different. Now, there are some people who like these types of bread and butter cases, and really that's all they want to do. They don't want to specialize. They like doing these general types of cases, and you can have a good diverse type of caseload with just these bread and butter type surgeries. And just like with every anesthetic, people react differently to things. It's not like by doing these general bread and butter surgeries, you're not going to have exciting days and you're going to have patients react bizarrely to certain anesthetics and keep you on your toes. You're going to have some of those scary oh crap moments even in your general bread and butter type cases, because that's just the nature of human physiology and in the way anesthesia works. Sometimes they say 90% of the time we're calm and relaxed, and then 10% of the time in anesthesia it's terrifying moments, and that's pretty accurate. So even with bread and butter, don't think about the people who prefer to do bread and butter surgery anesthesia type cases that they're choosing like a boring laid-back life, because there are definitely challenges in that. But let's branch off into our first specialty if you chose to specialize. The first specialty that we learned in school and I rotated within was pediatrics. Now pediatrics, some people love pediatrics. Same for when you were an RN back before school. Some people wanted to be a pediatric nurse or an OB nurse, so they wanted to deal with NICU babies or pediatric ICU babies and stuff. That was never my thing. I feel like it takes a special personality to be very good with pediatric patients, and there's definitely an element to pediatrics that's kind of like being a therapist. By saying that you have to be an anesthesia provider and a therapist, I'm meaning pediatrics is the only area that I practiced in where I have to actively try and convince the patient that they actually want me to give them anesthesia, because in peds, they actively do not want you to give them anything. They don't want that medicine. They don't want that shot. We don't usually give shots, but that's in their head what they're thinking. They see you in their frame of reference, memorization of doctor's visits and stuff is immunization shots and just things that make them uncomfortable. So they're automatically afraid of you. They're in a hospital environment. They're not comfortable. Pediatrics usually has, especially specialty pediatric hospitals where I rotated as a student, they're gonna have like child therapist specialists or whatever who are usually stationed in pre-op, and they usually wear like fun colors and have funny hats, and they all have like toys with them, and they'll bring like an iPad preloaded with a bunch of kids games and stuff, and they'll go to pre-op and they'll sit down with a kid and pretty much just try and be their friend and play with them and build trust. There's a lot of that you have to do. And then when you come in, whether it be the surgeon or the anesthesia provider, to do a pre-op or talk to them about anything medical, you can't just go straight to your medical jargon of like going through your business of what you need to talk about. You have to kind of like play with them, make them like you, trust you. Sometimes you have to hold them, especially if it's like a younger kid. Sometimes you have to hold them to get them to do what you need them to do. It's just very different for maybe moms or even dads who have a lot of experience with kids. Maybe that comes more natural. For me, who was like a 30-year-old who's never had kids, that is different to walk into a room of a child you just met, and now you have to kind of like hold them, and they're like drooling on your shoulder or something, and you're trying to like explain to the parents the anesthetic that you're going to perform and try and get a background history on the patient to even figure out what's the safest method for them. Normally, you're going to ask them to open their mouth like a normal patient. You're going to say, open your mouth, stick out your tongue. You're going to check mouth and potty scores. You're going to do airway assessments. Kids really don't do that. They're not, a lot of times they're going to like clamp their mouth closed if you ask them to open up their mouth. Or if you say, open up your mouth, they'll go, like that. Like that's as much as they're going to open their mouth. They're not going to really let you see their mouth. You're not really going to get visualization. They're also going to have like lots of loose teeth because of course kids are losing teeth all the time. So it's going to be difficult to actually make sure their teeth are intact. And so yeah, it's just a totally different world when you're dealing with pediatrics. And that's why when people choose to specialize in pediatrics, they'll usually go to like a pediatric hospital, and that's like what they do every day because they just get in the rhythm of pediatrics and that type of anesthetic and that type of workflow because it's very different from adults. The other thing interesting about peds is their airways are different. As we grow and our anatomy changes, even from say a neonate, small, maybe newborn up into like a two-year-old, the airways change a little bit in the way that you can view them and how easy they are to establish an advanced airway changes even between that time frame. And then from 2 to 6, it changes a little bit more again. And then like 7 to 12, you know, it changes a little more. And then from like 12 and 13 up, usually their airways are more straightforward. Yeah, so I mean, their airways can be much more complex. Sometimes they can be very easy, but other times they can be complicated in peds. Very reactive airways in young kids. So oftentimes people will wake, or they'll extubate a patient deep who's a pediatric patient to keep them from laryngospasming or coughing or having bad responses like that. They'll extubate deep and then, you know, use positive pressure like a Jackson Reese mask to, you know, help them along to PACU. So that's different. Like I don't do that in my adult patients usually. And of course, as you probably expected, the drugs are a little different. There are certain drugs you don't give to certain pediatrics, like maybe if they're less than 2 years old. And then other drugs that you do give to a pediatric patient, there's very specific guidelines to like this point something milligram per kilogram of what you give, and you don't give more than that. Whereas in adults, there's a lot more wiggle room. You know, a little bit of a change in a dosage usually is not going to affect a large adult very much. But in a pediatric patient, a little variation and change of your calculation could have a very different effect. So you have to have very precise medication drawn up and very precise administration of what you're giving. Also, the types of cases in pediatrics are a little bit different. Like you'll sometimes be doing congenital heart anomaly repairs and stuff in pediatrics that you don't normally do in adult patients. Of course, like circumcisions, there were days when I, on my pediatric rotation, where the whole day was just circumcisions, back to back to back, surgical circumcisions. There's lots of tonsils and adenoids being taken out, TNAs as we call it. So you might have an ENT day where you do like 14 of those cases back to back to back to back all day. And in adults, it's not that common to do that procedure, especially not all day long. Another difference is usually if you work in a pediatric group or a pediatric hospital, there's going to be someone stationed in MRI almost every day, because for adults, you don't think about this. It's not normal to have to put somebody to sleep to do an MRI. Or maybe a CT scan, but in pediatrics, it's very common for a kid to pretty much need general anesthesia in order to get a basic scan like that done. So there were many a days that I would spend an MRI or CT doing general anesthesia on patients who just needed to stay still long enough for a CT scan or MRI. So overall, pediatrics, really interesting environment. I do feel like there is kind of a vibe that pediatrics has, and if you get into the rhythm of it, which I did after a month or so of doing it over and over, I kind of got in the rhythm of peds and I started to like it. So I do see the merits in that, and occasionally I do like to have a pediatric patient. Me personally is not what I want to do every day all the time, but I have friends that have chose pediatrics to specialize in. That's what they do, and they work in a pediatric anesthesia group, and that's what they love. They don't want to work with adults. And so there's always that option for you. The second most common specialization is obstetrics. Now, a lot of times, in fact, I'd say most of the time, Obstetrics is going to be included in with your bread and butter type anesthesia. Most groups are going to cover obstetrics as well as their normal surgeries, even if it's a smaller hospital, because pretty much everywhere in the nation, moms are going to get pregnant and have babies. And so if you're offering anesthetic services, it just makes sense for you to offer epidural and C-section services as well. But obstetrics is an area of anesthesia where things are just slightly different. You know, of course, your patients are pregnant. Their physiology is in a different place at that point in their life. Their blood volume, the way they react to certain things are different. Your approach is going to be different. Their airways are different. So I include it here under specialties, even though usually people don't just go, there's not usually an obstetrics hospital that you just go work at that does obstetrics, but there are some people who specialize. I would say they do their research in obstetrics. They primarily try and work in obstetrics, and they try and do the majority of their rotations and time in a group in obstetrics. So that's kind of why I'm including it here. And I will say, you know, obstetrics, definitely there are people who are great at it, and there are other people who are just kind of okay at it, and there are other people who really hate it and really try and avoid it all the time. So I fall in the middle there. I would say I'm fairly decent at obstetrics, and I do kind of like it. I don't want to do it every day all the time, and it certainly isn't something that I would want to like invest all of my energy into. But I also feel like if I didn't do it at least some, I would start to miss it. Because it's just like with pediatrics, obstetrics has a different vibe to it. You're not really in the OR as much when you do obstetrics. You're usually in a labor and delivery floor, and you're usually with a lot of labor and delivery OBGYNs, and you're hanging out with the OBGYNs and the nurses who are, you know, helping the patients out, and you're talking to the family members, and you're really interacting with a lot of patients who are cognitively aware. You know, they're not asleep for surgery. They're very much awake, and they're actually going through one of the most special, exciting, and also stressful moments of their lives, and you get to be a part of that. So what do you particularly do as an anesthesia provider in obstetrics? Primarily what people are gonna think about is epidurals. So everyone knows someone who's had an epidural. Maybe you've had one yourself, or at least you've seen somebody on TV talking about an epidural. That is simply where someone is going through, well, you can do an epidural for pain and other things, even general surgery purposes. But for the obstetrics, we're gonna say epidurals are usually for labor pain. So you're gonna put in a lumbar epidural so that you can cover the nerve endings near the spinal cord back there on the outside in the epidural area. You're gonna infiltrate that area with local anesthetic, and that is gonna numb up those nerves, usually from the waist area, maybe a little higher than that down, and that's gonna just numb some of that pain, so when the mother's going through labor, it doesn't feel as painful to her. She'll still feel the pressure of the contraction. She'll probably still know that she's having a contraction, but it won't be bothersome to her. So that is a big part of what you do in OB, is put in epidurals and then manage them on the floor. The other aspect of what you do often in OB is C-sections. Some mothers choose to schedule a C-section. They don't want to go through labor. They don't want to push the baby out vaginally. They want to have a C-section, which is where they get cut open in the pelvic region and the baby is removed, and that's more in the OR suites. Labor and delivery usually has their own OB ORs, which are just usually one or two of them, depending on the size of the facility, but usually there's a handful of little L&D OR suites where they'll do their C-sections, and those are usually planned and scheduled, but those also cannot be planned and scheduled. Those can be emergencies. They can be at 2 a.m. when you're on call covering OB. So usually if you're covering OB, pretty much always when you're covering OB, somebody's got to be on call. Whether they're going to stay in-house or they're going to take call from home and be close by, someone's got to be available at all times, because a mother could have an emergency at any time and you have to respond immediately to that. So for C-sections, we don't usually use epidurals. Sometimes I will dose an epidural if a laboring mother has something go wrong and needs to convert to a C-section. You can dose through an epidural so that you don't have to do another anesthetic type, and sometimes that can be effective, but sometimes it can be spotty, not very effective. If a mother is coming in from home, she's not in labor, she has no epidural, what I usually do and what almost all people do is a spinal anesthetic. And so that's similar to an epidural, but it's typically a one shot. injection. So you do a one-shot injection, and then that numbs the mother, usually from the xiphoid process area, maybe a little lower down. This is your xiphoid process, by the way, I'm sorry. That's the lower end of your sternum. It numbs them, and then they don't feel anything, and they really can't move anything. It's a more powerful response than an epidural, and they're not really gonna be able to move or feel much of anything, except maybe a little bit of pressure for about 2 hours, typically, depending on what local anesthetic you use. So that's the typical way that we do our C-sections, and oftentimes OB CRNAs or physician anesthesiologists, when you go in to cover OB, you may have three scheduled C-sections for that day, and you might stay all night and cover in the call room for, you know, late night epidurals that need to be placed or other various needs. So OB has got its own vibe. It's got its own kind of tasks and roles, and it's definitely a different workflow than your normal day in the OR doing a bunch of general surgeries. The next specialty is cardiothoracic or cardiac. This types of surgeries, usually like CABGs, valve repairs, maybe a TAVR, certain things like that. That's typically people who like doing advanced cardiac like that, they usually specialize in it. They usually do that all the time. These types of cases are more intense, I would say. They require more setup, more machinery, you use more skills. Typically you put in a Swan-Ganz catheter on these patients. You do a lot of hemodynamic monitoring. These patients, you know, require a lot of attention. Usually if they are needing a valve replaced, CABG done, something like that, these are people who are usually not your healthy patients. They usually have a bunch of other comorbidities and other risk factors and issues. So these are usually people who prefer to go into cardiothoracic anesthesia. Typically are people who are looking for, you know, the adrenaline. They're looking to like work hard pretty much, but they get into a rhythm of it. And honestly, once you do it over and over and over, just like with the other specialties, you get in the groove of it. You become very good at that one thing, and that becomes that thing that you like to do. So that just, it makes sense for people who prefer cardiothoracic to kind of stick with it and do it all the time. So that when there are those complicated LVAD type surgeries and, you know, people who are very cardiac ill, you have somebody who's very good at managing those types of cases. I have to say, my cardiac rotation was probably my least favorite rotation in all of CRNA school. Cardiac's always been something I thought was interesting and I liked a little bit, but it's never been the thing that I like to spend all of my time and energy into. And I will say the CRNAs who trained me, who ran the CV department at the hospital that I rotated at, they were brilliant and very skilled and definitely, you know, demanded a level of excellence that that was very hard to live up to. But they pushed me, and you know, you become better as you go along. And the last common specialty that people like to work into is neuroanesthesia. So if you really are good at neuro, you prefer brain, you have craniotomies, big cases like that, there are certain things that you want to focus on in neuroanesthesia. There's certain drugs that you may like to give more, like mannitol, things like that, and there may be other drugs that you will avoid in neuroanesthesia because it may increase cerebral blood flow and things like that. So it is good, really good at neuro, and you prefer that type of anesthetic, that you do a lot of neuro and you get into a rhythm of maybe not using paralytic. A lot of times in spine or brain cases, there'll be times where they say, don't use any paralytic. I want you to use no paralytic because we're going to do nerve monitoring here. And you kind of get in the flow of, okay, we're doing nerve monitoring now. And so I need to change my anesthetic methods up to accommodate that. And you're also doing a lot more neuro checks. Oftentimes you need to wake the patient up and do a neuro check. Sometimes even during surgery, they want to check nervous function. There have been, when I was a student, there was one neurosurgeon who liked the patient to be awake enough that they could continually do neuro checks throughout surgery with the patient awake. So neuroanesthesia is definitely a different type of anesthetic than a lot of your other ones. And there are people who just generally like that stuff. They like neuro, they like the brain, they like studying it, they like putting time for research into it. And so they're really good at it. I learned a lot from those kind of people. I would say I like neuro somewhat. It's definitely not something that I want to spend all my time into, but I do like it a little. The last specialty that I will mention is critical care medicine. CRNAs don't often go into critical care medicine because it's not really our background. You know, we were nurses first, and we did critical care nursing our time as an RN, but we didn't really focus as much on the medicine side of things. It was more of like nursing care and you know, being part of the management team and like being a part of those discussions and conversations and trying to anticipate things. And, you know, we titrated drips and stuff, but we were not the medical provider overseeing everything and making all the decisions. For us, when we go into CRNA school, it's our choice to specialize in providing anesthesia. And critical care medicine is kind of more of a physician specialty. For physician anesthesiologists, they prefer to go into critical care medicine sometimes. And that way they can use a little bit of that med school background that they have that they don't get to use as much in the anesthesia role. And then they get to kind of use that role in the critical care medicine side. So I do know some great physician anesthesiologists who do critical care. They did a critical care medicine fellowship, which is an extra year after their residency. And they develop more of that intensivist type mindset in the long-term management of patients, maybe long-term management on ventilators and things like that. It does kind of go hand in hand with anesthesia, and there are some roles that we will play in the ICU and help out in the ICU. And there are some CRNAs I know who chose to go get their NP license. It's about an extra year after we graduate school. You can get your NP license in about a year. They do that, and then they work at a smaller hospital. So at that smaller facility, they ask them to help manage people in the critical care units. And to kind of like round a little bit, maybe help in the ER. And by having their NP license, it gives a CRNA the flexibility of more of the medical provider role outside of the anesthesia realm. And so they like that. And so if you chose to want to do that later on in your career, you can always do that. Well, guys, I guess I have talked long enough about the different areas of anesthesia that you can work in, the different specialties. If I blanked and forgot something, I know some people will say there's a fellowship for regional anesthesia. Yes, and pain management. And that's true. You can do regional anesthesia and pain management. There are very few CRNAs who play that role. There are some. I do know some who do pain management and regional anesthesia, but it's very few. And there are quite a few physician anesthesiologists who choose to specialize in pain management. So yeah, that's always something you can do too. It's kind of like an offshoot area of anesthesia, and you don't really do as much of the normal anesthesia that I've described to you in these other types of roles. But yeah, there's definitely a place for that too if you would choose to do that. I want to hear from you guys below if you want to work in any one of these types of specialties. If you got done with CRNA school or got done with your residency as a physician and you wanted to specialize, what specialty would you go into? What sounds interesting to you? You know, it's funny how when I was in nursing school or was an ICU nurse before and was thinking forward to when I was going to do anesthesia, I didn't have a clear idea of exactly what each of these roles were like. And you really won't know until you start your rotations what an actual day is like doing pediatric anesthesia or doing obstetrics or doing cardiothoracic. And that's when people really understand, like, this is what I want to know. But I kind of want to hear from you guys what you think right now is going to be the most exciting. And if you have any questions about any of the specialties, of course, ask me down below and I'll try and answer you guys. Make sure and go over and follow me on Instagram. It's BoltCRNA over there. Click the membership over here, guys. I want to see more of you guys involved. There's so many of you guys who engage with me and talk with me and want this mentorship and help. And so I've got that membership option out there for you. And I'd love to see you over there joining in. Even if you just join the simple 99 cents a month silver membership, I get to do that live Q&A with you once a month. You get that free 26-page study guide to help you for CRNA school interviews. It's a really great value. I hope to see more of you guys on there. And that's Bolt out.